One of the most common criticisms often levied at Godzilla King of the Monsters is that it is dumb, a loud, obnoxious action film more focused on crafting massive set-piece moments over telling a compelling story with likable characters. Even those who champion the film do so with the thought that there's nothing of substance going on, that they enjoy it because it is a big, dumb monster movie that satisfies on the most basic level. However, having seen the film, gosh, I don't even know how many times now, I've come to the conclusion that the film isn't quite as mindless as it's perceived. Granted, it has a lot of problems, and its lack of smaller moments does rob the bigger moments of their impact, but I don't think enough credit is given to the story and the themes it touches upon, and I include myself in this. If you go back and look at my history with this movie from its release all the way until now, you will see that I initially was lukewarm on it, and even as I began to warm up to it upon subsequent rewatches, my enjoyment often came with the caveat that it is dumb fun, and nothing more. And there will be nothing wrong with that. Dumb fun is at the center of what makes many of the Godzilla movies enjoyable, and while I'm not going to sit here and claim King of the Monsters is high art, it's not, but within the framework of a giant monster blockbuster spectacle, I do think it is smarter than many people realize, and its ambitions are quite admirable, even if it doesn't quite stick the landing in some cases. Director and co-writer Michael Dougherty has said numerous times in pre-release interviews that with King of the Monsters, he wanted to put the god in Godzilla, and now having seen the film, we can see exactly what he meant. No film in the franchise has more explicitly treated these characters as gods, nor crafted a story quite like the one being told here, which is, at its heart, underneath all the crazy action and special effects, a not-so-subtle spiritual myth about the relationship between mankind and God. Only in this story, God happens to be a giant 400-foot-tall radioactive dinosaur. First, let's start with the obvious, the monsters, or as the film likes to call them, Titans, which is a reference to the figures of Greek mythology. The Titans were the first gods that preceded the Olympians, elemental deities usurped by Zeus and cast down into Tartarus, where they were held captive for the rest of time. But not all the Titans were imprisoned. Some were allowed free, including one named Oceanus, a personification of the world's water, and himself a great river that encircled the world, connecting all the realms together. Unlike the other Titans, he was passive and liked to be left alone, and thus did not participate in the war against the Olympians. Sounds vaguely like a certain Lizard King, doesn't it? I know I'm probably making too much out of this, but it's an interesting parallel I stumbled upon when researching for this. Anyway, aside from being cool, calling the Kaiju Titans is a very explicit mission statement by the writers. In this story, these creatures are not mere monsters, they are quite literally gods, one we, humanity, had originally had a deep connection with, as shown by various temples, cave paintings, and hieroglyphics prominent throughout the film. Through these, we see that an ancient, more primitive form of humanity in fact worshipped Godzilla. This connection created a balance, keeping humanity in check in exchange for their protection. However, at some point this connection was severed, and Godzilla and the Titans were cast down, and with that the natural world was thrown off balance, and ever since, without them to keep our ego in check, we have been strip mining the planet, taking and hoarding its resources until now when the balance has tipped toward extinction. This fate is what Emma Russell is fighting to stop, and it is her opinion that awakening the Titans, returning us to subservience and letting them rule the world as they once did, is the most assured way of stopping this extinction. As she points out in her conveniently placed PowerPoint presentation, the Titans' natural radioactivity acts as a jumper cable of sorts to nature. Life flourishes wherever they go, and so her conclusion is that by setting them free, the destruction mankind has caused the planet can be reversed. In her zealotry, however, Emma makes a terrible mistake, setting free a Titan so powerful and so evil that it threatens to upend the entire world of Titans and man alike. That Titan is of course King Ghidorah, an alien who long ago arrived at Earth to conquer and terraform it for himself. Luckily, Godzilla, the Alpha Titan and Earth's protector, was there to stop him, casting him down into the depths of Antarctica for attempting to usurp him. But now, thanks to the misguided interventions of man, he is free again, and once again, Godzilla has to go to war. Let's pause for a minute and talk about Ghidorah. Godzilla and Ghidorah have always had an intense rivalry, at least in a meta sense. After his introduction in Ghidorah the Three-Headed Monster in 1964, he has since been looked upon as Godzilla's greatest and most iconic enemy, the Joker to Godzilla's Batman. But if you actually go back and look at every encounter he's had with Godzilla, reality has never quite aligned with this view. Godzilla and Ghidorah are rarely presented as having history. The closest is in the Showa series, and while you do get a vague sense of it if you read between the lines, it's not ever developed in accordance with the story. Going into the Heisei and Millennium series, they would fight a few more times, but always with altered backstories and circumstances. Basically, there was never any drama to instill a sense within the viewer that these two are rivals. King of the Monsters is the first film to do this, and within a story about gods and men, Ghidorah takes on a significantly more sinister role than he ever has before. To be frank, he is pretty much the devil. I mean, just look at him. He looks like he wants to rip your heart out and drink your blood. In both design and performance, he is explicitly snake-like, all slithering necks, forked tongues, and tails that rattle like a rattlesnake's would. This is all very intentional, of course. Snakes have long been synonymous with Satan. It is the form in which he tempted Eve to eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And Ghidorah's personality certainly aligns with this. He is shown numerous times to play with his food. The very first thing he does when he wakes up after being asleep for thousands of years is fry the puny humans shooting their dumb little guns at him. Not because they are even close to being a threat, but because he wants to. He enjoys it. The environments around Ghidorah also play into this satanic interpretation. Having him awaken from the bowels of Antarctica wasn't chosen just because it is cool, no pun intended. It is the closest thing to hell on the planet, at least to humans, a sort of underworld of the Earth, here shown to be cold and windy, almost incomprehensibly dark and caked with snow. Ghidorah brings this underworld with him wherever he goes. Rain and wind and lightning encompass him, shrouding him in darkness and shadow. Sure, this does conveniently obscure the monster fights, but it does add an elemental sense of grandeur to them that communicates to the audience how powerful Ghidorah is, and what his release means for Godzilla and the planet he protects. It sets the stakes. More than ever before, Ghidorah is the harbinger of the apocalypse, and more than ever before, Godzilla is the only one who can stop him. Now, if only us dumb humans understood this and got out of the way, but we don't. Instead of putting our faith in Godzilla and letting him bring balance, humanity intervenes and makes things worse, injuring Godzilla and thus allowing Ghidorah free reign over Earth and the other Titans, who become his servants, pawns to usher in a hellish new world. Both this and the release of Ghidorah play into the themes of trusting nature inherent to the Godzilla franchise, but within this film it shows firsthand the kind of destruction that comes about when mankind fails to have a relationship with the Monster King. Without faith, faith in God, in Godzilla, we're left scrambling in the dark, throwing weapons of mass destruction around in a vain effort to solve our problems, and for every problem they solve, 10 more take their place. This is, of course, very true to human nature, so the film is spitting some hard truths here, all without talking down to the audience. These developments are part of the story, and the ideas behind them are there if you choose to see them. So with humanity having crucified their savior instead of trusting him, and with the world thrown into chaos and pandemonium, mankind now has a choice: repent or die. Ask for forgiveness, re-establish connection with God, and trust in him to save us, or fight alone and face certain extinction. The choice is obvious, even to those who resent Godzilla like Mark, and it becomes their mission to revive him. Unfortunately, to do so requires penance, a willing sacrifice, and what better one to give his life than Dr. Sarazawa, the man who has dedicated it to understanding Godzilla and trusted him when so many others did not. The moment that follows is the best scene in the film. Not just because it's just so well done, but because of its significance, both within the film and within the greater franchise. Within over 60 years worth of films, it is the only time a human has ever touched Godzilla, signifying the importance of the ancient connection that was lost and now found again. Sarazawa's final words also signify this, as Godzilla is humanity's old friend, one we had so arrogantly left behind. But in these trying times, at the end of the world, we have learned our lesson, and it is time for the king to rise once more, to face his ancient enemy for the final time, maybe. But what about the other two monsters? How do Mothra and Rodan fit into all this? Well, with Godzilla and Ghidorah operating as the film's primary hero and villain, it makes sense that these two would end up being supporting players in their conflict, and like both Godzilla and Ghidorah, are given mythological interpretations in ways that enrich their symbolism. For Mothra, as described by Dr. Chen, she is the queen of the monsters, Godzilla's guardian angel who helps him protect his throne and the planet at any cost. When she is born, she wastes no time metamorphosizing into her adult form, but not in time to aid Godzilla before he ends up injured by humanity, so she takes it upon herself to guide them, to show them a way to repent and bring him back. And when Godzilla returns and takes the fight to Ghidorah, she is there by his side, and is even willing to lay down her life to protect him when Ghidorah has him cornered. Even in death she is there, her spirit transferring inside Godzilla to give him the power boost needed to kill Ghidorah once and for all. Then there's Rodan, which Dr. Chen calls the Fire Demon, an appropriate name as he is portrayed here like a phoenix, his wings burning with embers. Unlike Mothra, who is purely selfless, Rodan is a Judas-type character, willing to switch allegiances at the drop of a hat, serving whomever best serves his interests, which for most of the film is Ghidorah. Thus, he becomes an agent of the Devil, a demon who cleanses the world below him with hurricane-force winds, clearing the way for his king's new world. Like all good toadies, though, Rodan manages to worm his way out of the other side of the conflict, bowing to his new king, though it is certain that Godzilla will be keeping an eye on him. So we've gone over the monster stuff, but what about the humans? How do they play in all this? Many people would agree that the human element is the weakest part of the movie, but even that might be a bit more sophisticated than is given credit. While the film is composed of a large ensemble, as many Godzilla films are, the core that brings them all together is the Russell family. They are the human heart of the story, the connective tissue that brings meaning to the drama going on between the gods above them. The film opens on the past, where their family was torn apart by a tragedy indirectly of Godzilla's making. This schism splits the matriarch and the patriarch of the family into two opposite and opposing ideologies on how to deal with the Titans, one that we see play out and conclude throughout the film. Both of these characters' positions are fueled by the pain of losing their son. Emma chooses faith in the Titans to give her life purpose, to give her son's death meaning, while Mark, on the other hand, loses all faith and grows to resent the Titans, especially Godzilla, whom he has a personal grudge against. And so we have two opposing forces when it comes to humanity's relationship with the Titans, dogma versus doubt. Emma is shown to be dogmatic and trust in the Titans so much that she is willing to bet all of humanity's future on them, believing that we must give the Earth back to them to survive. Mark, on the other hand, hates them and wishes them all dead, believing the world is better off without them. And as the film goes on to show, both of them are wrong. Like with nature itself, a balance is necessary to achieve inner peace. Emma does terrible things to achieve her goal. As her daughter Madison points out, in trying to save the world, she becomes a monster herself. Emma realizes this, and her mission to save Madison becomes her own personal penance. She goes on to sacrifice herself for her sins, buying time for both her family to escape and for Godzilla to get back on his feet and continue the fight. Mark's journey, on the other hand, is that of acceptance. He begins the film with a steadfast hatred of Godzilla, and it is only as the film goes along that he realizes how misplaced his anger is. With each encounter, Mark understands a little bit more. When Godzilla seemingly dies and all hope of finding his daughter seems lost, he tries to run away, just as he did before. But before he can do so, Mothra reveals herself in a blindingly beautiful display of optimism. Like an angel, she quite literally shows him the light, arriving at his lowest point to offer him an answer. Repent, save Godzilla, and learn to coexist. And he does this, being the one to come up with the plan to revive and supercharge him with one of America's many nukes just lying around. And after doing so, when Godzilla is reborn and rises in all his supreme glory right in front of him, they meet eye to eye for the second time in the film, only this time there is a clear understanding going on, an acceptance of the other. It is in this scene that the ancient connection between humanity and Godzilla is firmly reestablished, and Mark sees Godzilla for the first time for what he is, a protector, not a monster to hate, but an all-powerful living being to have faith in. And it is also with this revelation that he realizes that the Orca, the device he and Emma had made to communicate with him and all the other Titans, was made by combining the bioacoustics of humans with Godzilla. Turns out the missing puzzle piece of saving the world and his daughter had been there all along, right in front of him. He was just too blinded by hate and pain to see it. Coexistence, the alignment of humanity with Godzilla, was the missing piece he needed to rescue the person that matters most to him. As for Madison, she represents the balance both of her parents need to find peace. She is constantly tugged and pulled between Emma and Mark throughout the film. And while at the beginning she is on board with her mother's plan to release the Titans, she was naive to the extent of its cost, and upon realizing this, takes it upon herself to right her wrongs. She puts herself in great danger, even facing off against our three-headed devil himself. And lo and behold, our lord and savior Godzilla arrives just in the nick of time, giving Mark and Emma time to come together after both had their epiphanies to save her. Just as in with Godzilla 2014, the reunion of the family symbolizes a bringing of balance. But while in 2014 this was more representative of a natural balance, here it's more spiritual, and more about the characters. What I find most interesting about all this spiritual gobbledygook running throughout the film is how it lies underneath the surface of a fairly straightforward science fiction-based world. Reliance on technology, on hard science, is the core foundation of the movie. comically so sometimes. There are monitors and tracking devices everywhere. Everyone has visual presentations ready on the fly, and information is constantly being spouted out at rapid fire by the characters, who, aside from the necessary military supporting players, are all scientists, each one with a specific role that contributes to the greater whole. The power of the collective has always been a thematic undercurrent of the Godzilla franchise, but here it takes on a more explicit, significant meaning given the film's intentions. And so King of the Monsters becomes a spiritual film that presents its spirituality in line with science, as opposed to being antithetical to it as it is more often presented, which is also in line with the traditional Godzilla storytelling. If you go back and watch the old Godzilla films, especially the classics, you can see the reverence they have for truth and science. The heroes are almost always scientists and reporters, and clever science-based solutions are always the key to saving the day. But underneath it all, there is also a sense of something greater, that science can be misused and abused in the wrong hands. Godzilla is himself a manifestation of this, a warning of the dangers of untapped scientific hubris. Science alone is not enough. A higher understanding is needed, a harmony, a balance of sorts, between science and spirituality, that sense of something greater. Merging of science and spirituality has always been a key component of Godzilla. The series is just as much fantasy as it is science fiction, and King of the Monsters keeps in line with this tradition, which I think is a nice touch, and shows that director Michael Dougherty knew what he was doing. The film hits at the core of what Godzilla has generally been about, even if the results are kind of messy, and some of the dramatic beats don't quite hit the way they intended. Then there are the little touches that I grow to appreciate more as time goes on. The soundtrack by Bear McCreary is one of the franchise's best, blending classic themes with a wholly original score that gives a potent voice to everything I just outlined. I especially love the use of Japanese Buddhist monks. Their chanting elicits feelings of awe and wonder and give the film an ancient biblical feel, while also paying tribute to the franchise's Japanese roots. I like the idea and implementation of the orca. Initially, I was wary of the concept of a device that allows humans to talk to the monsters. I thought bringing them down to our level would rob them of their power, but in the context of this film, it works very well. In a way, it is the perfect representation of what the film is about. It is literally a merging of science and spirituality, a piece of technology that essentially acts as a prayer device. I also really like the overall world of the film. I like how casually over-the-top it is. I mean, the characters spend over half the film flying around in an awesome giant jet called the Argo, another ode to Godzilla films of past, as is Monarch itself, which is a super cool organization that helps connect all the various moving parts of the plot together. And while the characters aren't the greatest, there are little moments that are easily missed because the film operates on such a breakneck pace. Moments like when Chen explains the difference between Eastern and Western concepts of dragons, and when Serizawa explains the nature of faith, are both solid character moments that contribute to Mark's arc. There's a lot of these little touches all throughout the film. It's just hard for them to stick sometimes because there's so much going on. If there's one criticism that can be levied at the film that I think everyone can agree with, it's that it speeds along so fast that moments like when Mothra hatches for the first time, or when Madison has to choose between her mother or her father, feel a little weightless because there's so much to process between them that you can't soak it in. This is why pacing matters so much. When your film is mostly noise, the meaningful moments feel meaningless. King of the Monsters isn't quite that bad, but it gets dangerously close at times, and I can understand how so many can come out cold. Again, I'm never going to argue that King of the Monsters is some artistic masterpiece with deep, profound messages. It's not, and it doesn't aspire to be. Everything I just outlined is service level stuff. It's icing on the cake of what is at its heart meant to be a fun monster movie, and really nothing more. But monster movies, even the silly ones, are always better when they add a little substance to the sugary filling, and King of the Monsters does do that. The movie is as subtle as, well, a giant monster, and I would expect nothing less. But I do appreciate its attempts to give a little meaning to all the carnage, and that goes for all the MonsterVerse films so far. They all have interesting stuff going on underneath, many of which run throughout all the films, making them feel like a cohesive whole even as the tones vary wildly. I think that's what makes the MonsterVerse one of the better cinematic universes. Much like its core theme, they achieve a nice balance between mindless camp entertainment and interesting themes, themes that are central to what makes Godzilla and giant monster movies so appealing. I like watching massive creatures beating the crap out of each other as much as the next person, but if I can also spend a little time digging deeper, discovering little nuggets of conviction on the author's part, well, that just makes it all the better. So if you're so inclined, take another look at King of the Monsters. Like Mark, you just may discover something you never saw before.